Hi, everyone, and welcome to episode 13 of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. I'm a retired agent writing crime fiction inspired by actual FBI cases. In this episode, I get to interview Jerry Clark. Now, Jerry was the case agent on one of the most bizarre bank robberies in the history of the FBI. Do you remember COLLARBOMB? That was the case involving a pizza delivery guy who claimed to have been forced to rob a bank with a time bomb locked around his neck. Now, everybody heard about the case because the bomb actually exploded and killed the pizza delivery guy. But most of us, like me, did not hear about the follow-up. Why was the bomb around his neck? Who was behind the bank robbery? Well, Jerry Clark was the FBI's lead case agent, and he worked this case with ATF and with the Erie Police Department, and he has all the behind-the-scenes information. Absolutely fascinating. Jerry Clark spent 21 years in federal law enforcement. He ended his career with the FBI, but he also worked as an NCIS agent and a DEA agent, so he's got a fascinating career. His interest in law enforcement was so strong that he actually earned a PhD in criminology and currently works as an assistant professor of criminal justice at Gannon University in Erie, Pennsylvania. Now, before we get to that interview, I just want to mention an email that I got this week. The email was from Ben, and Ben is a member of InfraGuard. And for those of you who don't know, InfraGuard is a partnership between the FBI and the private sector. Basically, people representing businesses and universities and other types of institutions and agencies, including state and local law enforcement, get together to share information and intelligence on ways to prevent the terroristic or hostile acts against our critical infrastructure, you know, such as energy and water and food and other type of facilities. So Ben is a member of that nonprofit organization, and he suggested that I interview somebody about a good cyber case. And that was a great suggestion. And I have somebody lined up to come at the end of May to discuss a cyber case. So if you have a suggestion, please don't hesitate to email me or tweet me or hit me up on my author page on Facebook and let me know. All right, here's the interview. And I'll talk to you some more when the interview's over. Hi, everyone. I am so excited to introduce to you my guest for today, Jerry Clark. Hi, Jerry.
Hi, Jerry. How are you?
I'm good. We won't forget each other's name during this interview.
That's very right.
All right. So just tease us a little bit about the case that you are going to talk about, because it is a very high-profile case that many people have heard about but don't know all of the behind-the-scenes facts that you're going to share with us today.
Well, Jerry, officially by the FBI title, it's titled as COLLARBOMB. We knew it here in Pennsylvania and some of the people who worked the cases, the pizza bomber case. And this may be one of the most fascinating criminal cases in FBI history, quite honestly. It has so many twists and turns in it, and it really turned out to be far more than just a bank robbery. And when I get into the details of it, I think your audience will find it truly fascinating.
Oh, I cannot wait. But tell me a little bit about you first. Just a quick overview of how you got into the FBI and the offices where you were assigned, and then we'll get right back and talk about that case.
Sure, and I think that's important related to this case, because I'm actually in Erie, Pennsylvania, born and raised person, and I had always wanted to be in the FBI, and it took me a number of steps to get there. I started out in adult probation for the Pennsylvania Erie County Department of Probation and Parole, and worked there about 5 years. Then finally, after applying to numerous agencies, got picked up by NCIS and moved to Philadelphia, where I spent about a year and a half in Philadelphia. then kept applying, you know, still with my eye on the prize for me, which was FBI. Next went to DEA and got transferred to Cleveland, Ohio. Spent 5 years in Cleveland, Ohio with DEA, and then finally got the call from FBI in 1995. So I started in about 1989, you know, with the federal system, and 1985 with my law enforcement system. But 27 years total. I started with the FBI in the Cincinnati division and worked out of the Dayton RA out of Cincinnati division, and then got, which the FBI agents know as an OP transfer or office of preference, transfer back home to the Pittsburgh division, Erie RA, where I spent my last 10 years of my career. So 27 years in the field, and never in my life and in my wildest dreams would I ever have expected any case like this one that we're going to talk about today, the pizza bomber.
All right. Well, let's get into it, because it's going to be fascinating, I know.
Yes.
So tell me, when you first, you know, what were you doing? What was going on when you first heard that there had been a bank robbery? Were you on the bank robbery squad?
Exactly. I've basically been a violent crime agent my whole career in the FBI, and with the drugs, of course, with DEA. So violent crime was my thing. You know, I loved reactive stuff. I loved going to cases. I worked on a fugitive squad while in Dayton, RA. You know, so we did everything related to violent crime. So bank robberies was really my sort of forte. So when I got transferred back to Erie, I thought, wow, they only have about 7 bank robberies a year here in Erie, Pennsylvania. It shouldn't be a lot of heavy lifting. Well, August 28th, 2003 came, and it was like any other day. You had 91 new, if you're an FBI agent, which means a 91 bank robbery, 91A, armed individual. This one was a little different, though, and it sounded different to me immediately when they said, you know, possible destructive device or bomb and being utilized. And you think, wow, okay, we've been to a number of hoax robberies over the years, hoax bank, you know, robbery specifically related to some sort of fake device used to rob a bank. But, you know, I responded, well, when I immediately got to the scene, I looked, and the individual who had went in and robbed the bank was already placed under arrest and was in dialogue with the Pennsylvania State Police right outside of their trooper vehicle. And so I pulled up in a position where I could overhear the conversation. This individual, who's later identified as Brian Wells, says that he's a pizza delivery driver, and while he's working his shift, they got a call for him to deliver 2 pizzas to a location right near where the bank was robbed. And at that time, according to him, he was accosted by some individuals. They put a device around his neck and told him he had to go rob the bank. And that was his discussion with us when I first arrived on scene.
Could you describe the device?
Sure. At the time, we couldn't see a lot of it because it looked like something that you would wear medically, you know, that if your neck was injured in an accident or something, and it was described even by some of the people in the bank as witnesses as one of those halo devices that go around someone's neck. But basically, it was a collar that wrapped around his neck like a large handcuff would. So it ratcheted shut. It had a box right underneath his chin that had 4 keyholes, and then it had a box that hung on his chest that contained, which we later determined to be, a live IED or intermittent explosive device. And that was underneath a shirt, a white T-shirt that had the word Guess written on the front of it, like Guess jeans. And again, that all played to the psychology of the people that were involved in this really maniacal crime.
All right, so tell us what happened. What did you do, you know, next?
Yeah, I mean, this is fascinating. And quite honestly, the true reason that this case has captured the public's attention like it has is, in my mind, for 2 reasons. One, it was captured on film. So you can actually watch this whole play a case play out right on an internet video. The second thing that I think captured people was it had never really been done before in the history of at least bank robberies that I've researched, where an individual walks into a bank wearing a live device that detonates during the course of the bank robbery, resulting in death. And it hadn't really happened before. But once we're there, conversations taking place, he's describing what and how he got in that situation, that these men accosted him, told him to put it around his neck, put it on his neck, and then sent him to the bank. He did exactly what they said. He was also given some instructions, or bank robbery notes, as they turned out, on what he was to do, and then other notes that were assigned to the bank teller and to the police department that's going to be responding. So in this case, there were 9 total pages of bank robbery notes, which is another really unique part of this case.
You call it unique. I think it's bizarre.
It really is. I mean, who would have that much, obsessiveness in this robbery? And if you look at the personalities, that's what it turned out to be. But in order to put together these 9 pages of notes. Now, what he was supposed to do is, and here's another really unbelievable part of the maniacalness of this, he was supposed to go in and rob the bank, ask for $250,000 in cash, which is an absolute, extreme amount. Then he was to get the money, exit the bank, and then do a series of scavenger hunts by following notes that gave him directions on sites to go to retrieve keys to unlock the collar from his own neck.
At what point was he supposed to give the money to the robbers?
That's the great question. And Jerry, when you look at this as a bank robbery, if he was to keep the money, and we looked at this, a number of ways during the course of the investigation, but if he was to rob the bank and keep the money while he's doing all these scavenger hunt, pickups, it would be a terrible plan, because at any one point he could be picked up by law enforcement and then the money would be seized by law enforcement. As it turns out, we find out later, he was to make a transfer of the money that he robbed from the bank to an individual, a co-conspirator in the plan, who would be standing outside of the bank, and then he was to go do those location retrievals for the keys. That would have made more sense, because now the money's away from him and he's able to go do those things. But because he was in the bank for a period of time, people had actually, witnesses and bank customers had actually got on 911 and were calling the police while he was even in the bank, saying, "Hey, I think this bank is being robbed, and I think this guy has a bomb around his neck." So that's why the state police, Pennsylvania State Police, who did a fantastic job in their response, were able to pull him over a very short distance from the bank. And that's when that dialogue started taking place.
Now, did he actually obtain money from the bank? Did they give him money?
They did. He was far, far short. And this is another one of those things that make this thing so ironic. When he was asking for the bank manager to get the $250,000, the bank teller said, "Hey, listen, the manager's, at lunch. You're going to have to come back." And he said, "Well, I can't come back. I'm robbing the bank." So he, as it turns out, Jerry, he only got about $8,207. So he was far short of the $250,000. When he exited the bank, he then had stopped about 100 yards from the bank at a McDonald's restaurant and inside the flower bed out in the parking lot. He went to this area in the flower bed and then turned over a note or a rock and was retrieving a note on where to go next in this scavenger hunt. So he stopped, got back in his vehicle, and started going to his second location when he was felony car stopped by the Pennsylvania State Police, and then that's when I arrived.
But what was supposed to have happened is that there was going to be somebody right outside the bank for him to hand the money to before he started to McDonald's and all the other scavenger locations.
Exactly. And that could never take place because everybody was watching him so closely. The person that was supposed to meet him saw that people were even on the phone and actually left before that transfer of the money could take place. So he actually had the money in his car. So while he's sitting discussing with us exactly what was supposed to happen, which he was continuing with the plan that they had provided for him to do, he said he was accosted, they put it on him, and he was doing the scavenger hunts. We had actually sent agents and officers to the pizza shop where he worked and found out where that last delivery was supposed to be that he had gone and had this device put around his neck. And so we had agents en route to that location. While he's talking to us, we hear a faint beep, 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 digital sound like a countdown timer, and then all of a sudden the device went off. And I'll tell you, Jerry, I've seen a lot of things over the 27 years. That was one of the most unbelievable things I've ever witnessed in my life. I saw him fall back because he was actually seated on the ground with his legs crossed, waiting for the bomb squad to arrive when the device went off. And he fell back. I saw the air go out of his chest, and it just never came back up. I knew right away that we had a fatal situation.
So did it actually explode? I mean, was he decapitated? Did it do damage to his body?
It did. It did severe damage to his chest. It did not decapitate him, but it dug a trench all the way down to his spine. So all his major organs on the front of his chest were now damaged, and he was actually pronounced dead immediately. Now, the interesting thing is, you know, again, having been to so many robberies, the chances of a hoax are far greater than a detonation. But
oh, absolutely.
When it went off, there was a collective, oh, my God. I mean, every law enforcement officer on scene couldn't believe it. Chaos immediately ensues, just like you'd have at any, you know, bombing event, you know, the Boston Marathon bombing or anything. People, you know, moving in different directions. Law enforcement, because we're so curious, we obviously want to run up and see what happened. But we had the wherewithal to say, you know, secondary, there could be another device, you know, there for first responders. So we were able to pull back and just sort of hold our position until the bomb squad, which was actually just on scene putting their gear on, could actually clear the scene. And
let me ask you this question. Before it actually detonated,
right,
did you believe that it was an actual bomb?
Honest. In my heart of hearts, I did not. I did not. I've seen flares taped together. I've seen a binocular case with an antenna sticking out, you know, all supposed to be bombs. Never did I believe. Now, as a law enforcement officer, and you had such a great career yourself, you know that the potential is always there. But if you were to ask me that, and I'd have to honestly say I wasn't thinking that it was going to be real.
I mean, that's, again, in so many bank robberies, and as you know, a lot of, you know, when you first join the FBI, a lot of new agents go on a bank robbery squad because it's the quickest way to learn from, you know, veteran agents of how to put a case together. So all of us have seen situations where somebody comes in, they don't have a gun, but they have a box,
right,
like you said, with wires out of it,
right,
and, you know, I'm going to blow the bank up if you don't, you know, give me the money. And so, yeah, we get kind of skeptical.
Absolutely true. You couldn't be more right. And having done hundreds of them, you know, okay, it's always there as a possibility, but you weren't, it was definitely something nobody expected. So immediately, you know, we were able to render what was left of that safe. Then the first thing we have to do is decide, all right, what do we do here? This is, you know, obviously an active crime scene. We need to canvass. We need to do interviews. But the first thing we want to do as law enforcement is find out where that last pizza delivery was made and where he was supposed to go on the scavenger hunt. So basically the FBI, Pennsylvania State Police, Erie Police, we took the notes that he was to follow, and then started to go run the scavenger hunt ourselves. And again, each of those sites have to be cleared and determine what's there. You don't know what you're going to find when you get there. Well, at the first site we went to, he used to get back on the highway, get off at an exit sign, go into the woods as he pulled over off the side of the road, go into the woods and retrieve more notes. Sure enough, law enforcement did it. We found it was a plastic jar with a orange top on it. And inside that orange top, there was another note. Pulled the note out. He was to get back on the highway, go the opposite direction, pull over at a sign, and then go into the woods there. When we got to that site, somebody had gotten to the site before we did. And so to this day, I don't know if that was a terminal site where, you know, he was to just stay, or if there were other notes there giving him other instructions, or what was to happen there, but somebody had retrieved whatever was there before law enforcement got there. So it was unbelievable. So then, you know, next thing you want to do, victimology, you find out, you know, everything you can about Mr. Wells, who's now deceased, find out if he had been involved in this thing or at least maybe done it himself. We didn't know what we had. We didn't know if we had a bank hostage. We didn't know if we had a cooperator, what the situation was, co-conspirator. So we started our immediate investigation by doing a search warrant at his house. Now, when we get to his house, we go inside, we breach that door because, you don't know what we're going to find in there. We've often seen booby trap situations of people going to houses after events were planned or done. But when we got in there, the only thing that was really, really significant was a list of names in a spiral notebook that Mr. Wells had of every person he knew. He was basically a very simple person, pizza delivery driver, not a lot of material goods, rented a little cottage behind someone's residence, lived very, very modestly. But he had a notebook, and in that notebook listed everybody he knew, and there were two names in there that nobody recognized from his family. And it turns out, after a subscriber check, that both belonged to two females, local prostitutes from the city of Erie, both having had arrests before. So now we're thinking, okay, how does this guy have these prostitutes' names and why? So we immediately tracked them down, and we started to develop information about the prostitutes.
When you first see these names, there is still no connection between these prostitutes and the bank robbery.
Nothing related to the bank robbery, just that he had them in his house. So now we're trying to figure out their connection. As it turns out, one of the females prostitutes used crack cocaine, and after we interviewed her, she said that Brian Wells used to drive her to different locations for her to purchase crack. He and her would, you know, consummate their sexual transaction. He would pay her for that action. She would then pay for the crack using the money she just got from Mr. Wells. So it was an interesting phenomenon, but we still hadn't made a relationship between her and him and the bank. So we continued on in our investigation. All that stuff's happening in the first 3 days. 3 days later, this is where this thing really starts to make some twists and turns. 3 days later, a second pizza delivery driver from the same shop. So you got to figure this bank or this robbery took place on a Thursday, August 28th. On a Sunday, we get a call that a second pizza delivery driver from the same shop, and Jerry, there was only two, he now dies of an overdose in his parents' house. We respond to that house. We're thinking, now this is really bizarre. There's only two pizza delivery drivers from this shop. They're both dead within 3 days. What's going on here? What's the connection? So we're immediately now focusing again on the pizza shop to determine, hey, what's going on at this shop? Is there something happening here that we need to know about? While we're investigating that, it's still not crazy enough. 3 weeks later, on September 21st, 2003, we get a call from a guy named Bill Rothstein, and he said, He calls 911. He said, my name's Bill Rothstein. Driving around in my van in Erie. I have a gun because I'm thinking of killing myself. And I need to tell you that there's a dead body in the freezer in my garage.
What?
And we're going, exactly. What? He went on to say, I didn't kill him, but Marjorie Deal Armstrong did, and she's at the house right now. You need to go arrest her. And I swear, this is a Sunday, and I get the call 5:30 in the morning, and we're thinking, this can't be.
Did this call go directly to the office, or did they have your number? Were they able to contact you?
They contacted me. It went right to the state police, Pennsylvania State Police, and the reason they contacted us and the reason that this thing is so interesting as it related to the bank robbery is the site where the pizza delivery man went to deliver the pizzas was down a dirt road at 8631 Peach Street in Erie. The guy who's calling in with the dead body lived right next door at 8645 Peach Street. So his house adjoined the driveway back where this guy delivered the pizzas. So now we're thinking, oh, my God, we got three dead bodies within 3 weeks, and we still haven't made a link between any of them, which was really the difficult part. So immediately we're interviewing Bill Rothstein and said, how did this guy end up in your freezer? He says, well, Marjorie Deal Armstrong dated this guy. They had an argument. She shot him twice with a shotgun in the back. She called me and asked me if I would help dispose of the body. And I said, well, why would you do that? And he said, well, you know, I'm a good friend of hers, and I thought I'd help her out, but this is not related to the Brian Wells case. And I kept saying, well, it's pretty amazing that it's right next door to this tower site. No, I never go back there. I don't know anything about that. I'll tell you, Jerry, the interview of him, and I'm telling your audience who probably know a lot about law enforcement, but if they don't, interviewing's everything in this job. And when I went in to interview him for the first time, Bill Rothstein, I walked in the room. He's sitting in there. Now, he had just turned in a body that's in the freezer in his garage. And I said, hey, Bill, I'm Jerry Clark from the FBI. Do you mind if I talk to you? And he said, no, I don't mind if you talk to me, but I need to tell you that I'm the smartest guy in this room.
Wow.
And I looked around, and it's just me. And I said, well, my wife tells me that every night, so let's get started. And that's how I started that interview, almost in a comical sense with him, because he had to show to me how smart he was.
You know, but usually the suspect is thinking that, and we know they're thinking that, but they don't say it out loud.
And that, Jerry, was the amazing part for me, because if you read the 9 pages of notes that I was privy to in the bank robbery, there was one made out to the police, and one of the lines in it said, we've spent a combination of 7.5 years in jail perfecting this plan. You're not going to figure it out in a week. And that was that same taunting, I'm smarter than you thought process from the author of that to the guy I just interviewed, Bill Rothstein. And so when I came out of that room after that initial interview, I said, this guy's involved. And I'm not sure how yet, and we got to make connections, but this guy is definitely involved.
Let me ask you before we move on, How was the state police able to talk him out of committing suicide and coming into the office?
That was the interesting part. Once I interviewed him, I realized he had never the real intention of doing that. He wanted to use that as a ruse for why he was going to turn himself in, because he was a narcissist, a true narcissist. He loved and believed strongly in everything about himself. I don't think he was going to ever kill himself, but he wanted to throw law enforcement off of what he thought was a trail or a track that might lead to him. Now, what was interesting was at his house, because we did a search warrant, obviously, when we recovered that body. And by the way, when you walk in, it's another one of those situations. This garage, if I can describe this for your listeners, was like a three-car deep garage. I mean, you could pull a semi in and shut a garage door on both ends, and it was filled with stuff from the front to the back like a hoarding show. And in the corner was a freezer, a chest freezer. And I'll never forget standing there with the coroner and some state police, Pennsylvania State Police guys. And I said, all right, here we go. Let's open it. Is there really going to be a body in this thing? And we flipped open the top, and I'm not kidding you. You couldn't make out the form, but there was something in plastic and wrapped in a tarp, and you knew that it potentially was a human body. And it just – again – If you see that for the first time and it's just surreal, you know, putting all the things that I've just had happen in the last 3 weeks all together, you just couldn't believe it. By the way, that body was so frozen in there that we couldn't get it out on scene. We had to pull the plug on the freezer, put it in the back of a van, and take the whole freezer to the coroner's office. It sat 3 days before it thawed enough to get that body out.
So it had been in there for a while.
It had been in there for a while, and that's exactly right. And we just could not get it out. Now, their plan was this, and here this still sound like something out of a Fargo movie, but their plan was to, once she killed the guy that ended up in the freezer, they were going to freeze his body, take a chainsaw, cut it up with a chainsaw, then run it through an ice chipper, and then distribute the pieces from the ice chipping all throughout the county as they drove around in a vehicle. And I heard the thing, and I just said, this all cannot be happening in one case. But again, we hadn't made any links yet, so our job as investigators are to take these three deaths and figure out how we can link them all together.
Now, the drug overdose death, do you know it's an overdose, or was he killed?
Well, that's the part that was so interesting. The only thing the toxicology would tell us is it's a combination of Xanax and methadone, which together synergistically is lethal, and we know that it was an overdose. We knew right away that's an active hotshot ingredient, quite honestly, that somebody probably gave him. But we had to show and try to put that together with how it might interact with our case. And that's what we had to do for the next several years. And here's why this took so long. Marjorie Deal Armstrong was arrested for killing the individual that was in the freezer in Bill Rothstein's garage. We immediately arrested her that day. We tried to interview her. She asked for a lawyer and was almost immediately, from her first court hearing, was declared incompetent to stand trial. So she was sent away
because
for competency. She had a background in mental health, and if you were from Erie, you knew that this was not her first brush with death. She had a boyfriend back in the 80s. That she shot 6 times as he was laying on a couch, and she was actually acquitted for the first battered spouse defense used in Erie County, was actually acquitted for shooting him 6 times and killing him. She then had a husband a couple years later after that incident of the first death around her, that she rushed to the hospital bleeding from his ear and said that he fell and hit a coffee table. He later died. We learned much later after this whole investigation, and there was never an investigation done because it looked like it was a medical situation, but determined that she hit him potentially in the head with a baseball bat, so he died. Then we had James Roden, the guy she killed in the freezer, shot twice with the shotgun, and then potentially, when we get the whole case put together, Brian Wells. So she's responsible for at least 4 deaths, and we know that there may be more. So this lady was no stranger to death, but they immediately declared her incompetent to stand trial and sent her away. So that left us.
But on what kind of behavior was she exhibiting that made them feel that she was incompetent?
Well, and I actually, Jerry, this is so funny. During the course of this case, when I had to learn so much about restoration, I went back for a PhD in criminology because of the fact that my dissertation was all on restoration to competence. She was declared incompetent. There's two ways, really, failing to be able to assist in your own defense and then being able to know the proceedings that are or that you're about to face. And she was really unsure, at least the judge was, that she was able to assist in her own defense. They knew she knew the proceedings very well. She knew the court system better than anybody in law enforcement, quite honestly, but they were worried she couldn't provide adequate assistance in her own defense, so they sent her away. And looking back now, I'm really glad that they did, because it might have been an appellate issue later, so I'd rather face it on the front side rather than the back side if we were going to end up dealing with that. But again, right at this point that we're describing, we have a homicide, we have, you know, because the James Roden's dead, and we know that the state police are going to charge that, but now we got to relate it to somehow being involved with the Brian Wells case, which is my bank robbery, and that was the difficult thing. And that was the same with the death of the second pizza delivery driver, Robert Panetti. So what we had to do then is start trying to make links. Well, while we're interviewing Rothstein, the guy who initially turned her in, he decided to cooperate with the death of the James Roden, the individual in the freezer, but he did not want to link the cases for us. And while we're interviewing him in July of 2004, so just months after the bank robbery, he dies of cancer.
Oh, wow.
So now I've got him dead, her declared incompetent, Brian Wells dead, and James Roden dead in the freezer, and Robert Panetti dead. And so we're left with, you know, trying to piece this together without being able to talk to her. Finally, in 2005, she's declared competent. They restored her, bring her back. She actually pleads guilty to shooting James Roden, the guy in the freezer, and receives 7 to 20 years, which was a real, in my mind, very light sentence. But I know they didn't want to go to trial and risk losing a case with her again. So they take the 7 to 20. But what was good about her being able to come in and plead is now I can finally go interview her related to the Wells case.
Okay.
So we went immediately down to the middle of the state of Pennsylvania, Williamsport area, Muncie State Correctional Institution, interviewed Marge. She said, listen, I'll tell you about the Wells case, but you need to move me closer to Erie. So I made some calls, got her moved to a prison closer to Erie. We start to interview her. She said, you need to look at a guy named Ken Barnes. So we started doing our research. We find out Ken Barnes is a television repairman who had a problem. And his problem was he became addicted to crack cocaine. We started to think back, where did we have crack cocaine in this case?
Right.
The prostitutes. So
right.
We went back to the prostitute. Hey, where did you get crack cocaine from? Well, here's a couple of the places. She drove us right to Ken Barnes's house. So now we can link Brian Wells, the guy who robbed the bank, with the prostitute who now links him with Ken Barnes, who now links with Marjorie Deal Armstrong. And now we're starting to finally put some pieces together.
And this is a name that you had not heard of before she provided the information.
She definitely withheld that, did not give us anything related to Ken Barnes until Marjorie told us, and we went back and talked to the prostitute who then showed us where she would buy crack cocaine. So as it turns out, it took a while to make the links, but now we started to finally make the links that these people all knew each other.
So
to wrap this thing up,
it's still not done. I'm still confused.
Yeah, it's still very confusing. So here's what we found out.
Okay.
The prostitute knew Brian Wells through their transactions where he would drive her around for crack. He drove her to Ken Barnes' house. Ken Barnes knew Marjorie Deal Armstrong, who knew Bill Rothstein. What happened was Bill Rothstein, Marjorie Deal, and Ken Barnes used to sit on Barnes' porch and talk about how they could get more money. Marjorie Deal Armstrong said, well, I'll tell you what, my father has about $2 million, which we are able to confirm, by the way, and he's not going to give it to me unless I can get him killed, and then I'll receive it as an inheritance. And Barnes said, being the nice guy he was, oh, I'll kill your dad, but I'm going to need about $250,000 to do it. Well, where am I going to get $250,000? Let's rob the bank. So the whole collar bomb, pizza bomber motive was to rob the bank to get the $250,000 to pay Ken Barnes to kill Marjorie Deal Armstrong's father to receive the large inheritance.
Wow.
And that's why they all constructed this plan. And what they did was when they used to see Brian Wells come over with the prostitute is say, hey, he'd be the perfect guy. So they talked to Brian Wells and said, Brian, how would you like to rob a bank for us? Only thing is, you'll be looked at as a bank hostage. You'll wear a device, but it'll be fake. It won't be real, and it's not going to do anything. But if you're caught, you just tell the police I was a hostage. If you're not caught, you rob it, we split the money, and you get some money. So Brian Wells actually agreed to participate in the bank robbery.
But, of course, he had no idea that the collar bomb would be real.
Absolutely true. What happens the day he shows up to deliver the pizzas, the day of the robbery, he finally sees the device for the first time as they're going to put it on him. He says, no, I don't want to do that. That looks way too real for me. And they said, you're going to do it. And they punched him, knocked him to the ground, put it around his neck, forced him to wear it, and he went and robbed the bank. Now, to his, I guess, mitigating factor, he was forced to do it. To his aggravating factor, he actually stuck with the story that they told him to say if he got caught. He could have ended it the day he was pulled over. He could have said, listen, Bill Rothstein, Marjorie Deal, Ken Barnes, they all put this around my neck. But he didn't. He said a group of guys shot at him, put it on him, forced him to rob the bank, and he never told us who did it and stuck to the story. Now, there's several reasons and theories why he stuck to their story, but I'll tell you, if he had just told us what happened, it would have been over that day. We're also starting out
– Not necessarily for him, because the bomb still would have detonated, no?
Absolutely true. There was no way that bomb was coming off, and – that was the maniacal part of this thing. They were never going to have him be a witness. Here's the second interesting part, and probably wondering about all the players. The second pizza delivery driver also was involved. His role was to make sure that Brian Wells followed along with the plan. So the day they put it around Brian Wells' neck, he was at the tower site where the pizza delivery man was delivering pizzas, and he was there and saw that put on his neck. He panicked after the device blew up, and that's when they thought, we can't have him as a witness, and that's when Barnes gave him a hot shot that they knew would kill him in the overdose.
Okay. All right, so we've got two bodies answered.
Exactly.
Who's the guy in the freezer?
Very good. That's where I was headed next, Jerry. The guy in the freezer, James Roden, was Marjorie Deal Armstrong's boyfriend. He had a role in the plot initially, but to his demise, he ended up telling her one day after a fight, you know what, I'm going to tell the police about that plan you have. I'm not going through with it. And she couldn't allow that to happen, so she had to dispose of him too.
Oh, she had to.
So,
I mean, she had no choice.
Exactly. In her mind, that's her next logical step. So she shot him two times in the back with a shotgun as he's laying on a bed, and that's how he ended up in the freezer. So if you look at this case, there were seven total co-conspirators involved. Four of them are now deceased. And Marjorie Deal and Ken Barnes both were indicted in 2007. And finally, it took till 2010 for her to go to trial because in federal court, she was sent back for competence again. So we had to wait till she got declared competent to come back in 2010. Barnes, to his credit, the crack dealer, came in and pled guilty to 45 years, Jerry. You almost never see that happen. He did get.
So he got more time than she did.
Well, as it turned out, she got charged by us. The 7 to 20 was on the state charge for killing Roden, but we charged her for the whole conspiracy on the bank robbery, and she went to trial. So after a three-week trial in 2010, she was found guilty by a complete jury of her peers and was sentenced to life plus an additional 30 years for using a destructive device. Barnes then got a reduction in sentence for helping as he came in and testified against her and laid out the whole plan for us.
Just absolutely fascinating. This is just so bizarre.
It really is. And when I try to put it together in a logical sequence, it's even difficult, even knowing, you know, as much as I know. So when my co-author and I, Ed Palatella, decided, hey, you know what? We need to write a book about this only because, and the only reason I did, Jerry, quite honestly, I'm an investigator. I never wrote any books. I never even thought of writing a book. But what happened was this thing was held under seal. Nobody knew anything about it. The investigators took a lot of heat during the course of the time of this thing because it took so long to put together. And I said, you know what? I'm going to do this book for two reasons. One, educationally, I think it'll help other law enforcement officers take a look. Number two, people need to know exactly the facts of what happened and to know how mean-spirited and evil people can be with other people. And that's why we decided to write the book.
And tell us a little bit more about the book. The name of the book?
The name of the book is Pizza Bomber, The Untold Story of America's Most Shocking Bank Robbery. And you can get it on any of the sites, Barnes & Noble, certainly Amazon. You can get it in a Kindle form or Nook form, so it's electronic. It has done extremely well. It's in its third printing. And we just optioned the book's rights with some people and producers who now have it in active development to turn it into either a feature film or a series, like a seven-part series, because it's so complicated.
Yeah, this is more like a series. I don't think – I mean, we were able to get through it talking about it, but there are so many details. My mind is buzzing with questions. I think it would be better as a seven-part series. So that's my vote.
I agree.
Tell me more about your co-writer.
My co-writer is an Erie Times News reporter, and he had covered the story from the very beginning, and he did such a fascinating job. I was both acting supervisor of the Erie office and working the case as a case agent, and so I would have to meet with him periodically. So I couldn't tell him anything. You know, I had to keep the integrity of the case. So he didn't know any part of this until after it was completely adjudicated and was done. I then retired from the FBI at age 50 after my years in and decided, you know what, we're going to write this book. We have written a second book since then called The History of Heist Bank Robberies in America, and that chronicles bank robberies from the very first one all the way to some modern ones, including the Pizza Bomber one, which, of course, we had to add in there. And then we're writing a third book right now, which is going to include Marjorie Deal Armstrong, and it's all about the psychology of females who kill. So
I want to get that one, too.
Right, exactly. That's going to be fascinating because she's an absolute case study in this book, and there's so few female serial killers, and Marjorie certainly can fit in that category.
This has just been a fascinating interview. You know, it's as an author, you know, a crime fiction author, I don't even think I could have made this up.
That's, Jerry, I go speak to this all over the country. I go to law enforcement groups. I go to Texas, Florida, talk to the most seasoned investigators. And without question, every break, somebody comes up to me and says, you had to make part of this up. And I said, I really wish I did. I can't even claim to. It's so true, and it's so hard to believe that it actually happened in real life exactly as I say it. So the book, it chronicles the whole investigation. It's really, I got to say, I couldn't have done it the way Ed Palatella did it. He did such a great job in chronicling what I had in my brain, and he was able to put that out there. And you can also get more information on pizzabomber.com, which is our website, which will show a lot of the places that I speak at, and also how to get the book if you're interested.
Fantastic. Now, just before we wrap up, yeah. You mentioned a dissertation. So
yes.
you have your PhD?
I do.
So what are you doing now? What are you doing with that?
You know what?
That doctorate.
I actually am a teacher at Gannon University, a professor in the Criminal Justice Department at Gannon University in Erie, Pennsylvania. We've got an unbelievable program here. I've filled it with all investigators who have hands-on experience like myself. In fact, our co-case agent, Jason Wick, special agent from ATF, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, I just now brought on staff with me. He worked that whole case with me. He knows it intimately like I do. We use the case as a case study in investigative concepts and careers in criminal justice and criminal law and procedure. All the classes I teach, I use direct information from this case, because it's just everything you do in a case, and you touched on this earlier, Jerry, and you couldn't be more right. A bank robbery has such perfect training skills for any investigator, because it works on so many different things. And so that's why people just love the program. The students love the hands-on, and I just enjoy now sharing the knowledge that I hopefully gained in a very happy career with the students here at Gannon, and I think they get a kick out of it.
Fantastic. All right. Is there anything else that you want to share with us or tell us about?
Well, certainly I'll tell you this. I'd love to come back on if anybody has questions, because a lot of times I'll go to a place, do a 3-4 hour interview or a presentation, and I'll have a half hour or more of questions. And I say, listen, I have no problem ever coming back on with you. If your listeners are interested, I'd love to come back on and speak more about it someday. And again, we can touch on some more of that new book with Marjorie coming out that would be interesting too.
Oh, I would love to do that. So tell us one more time where we can find you. How can listeners find you?
Listeners can find me at pizzabomber.com, www.pizzabomber.com, one word. And I have all my information on there. It gives a background. It gives some photographs in there. If you read the book, and again, you have questions, you can email me. My email's in there directly. Or, you know what, you can always, if you're interested, look at Gannon University. We have a brand new master's degree in criminalistics that I've devised here that I think is going to be all hands-on, and it's online, which is really what, people working in the field need to be able to continue their jobs and still advance themselves on the educational side, and that's something they might want to take a look at also.
And for those who are listening to the podcast, by way of my website, I'll have all the links to your website and to both books in the show note for this episode.
That's fantastic, Jerry.
Thank you so much, Jerry. It was a fascinating interview. It's a fascinating case.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And that's the end of the interview. I really enjoy talking to Jerry Clark. He is passionate about what he does. If you go to my website, jerrywilliams.com, of course, I have lots of photos of Jerry. I have links to both of his books. I also have a link to an original ABC news story about the pizza bomber. So if you want a little bit more information, please go to jerrywilliams.com and check it out. I also want to remind everybody that this is the week that I send out my first crime fiction newsletter. I'm really pleased with it. So the newsletter has several things in it. A list of what I believe are some of the best true crime and crime fiction books out there. Now, I'm partial to police procedurals, but I do have that list, those links to the books that I love. I also have a list of of all of the current TV shows that feature FBI agents, and I was amazed at the number of current shows about the FBI. And this is a very popular time for the FBI, which I guess is why FBI Retired Case File Review is doing so well. I also have just a small section about me. A number of people have asked for more information about me. There is an About Me page on my website, but not a lot of information. So I have a little section on the newsletter and a few pictures from my early days in the FBI. So if you're interested in receiving that crime fiction newsletter, again, I'll be getting that out on April the 20th. Then just go to my website. The pop-up will come right up for you to sign up for the newsletter, and I'll make sure to include you in the email that goes out. That is it for this episode of FBI Retired Case File Review. This episode is sponsored by FBIRetired.com, the only online directory made available to the general public featuring retired FBI agents and analysts interested in showcasing their skills to secure business opportunities. Thank you for listening, and I hope you come back again soon for another episode of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. Thank you.